Hello learners, welcome to EBS course of NIOS. I am Neelam Gupta, course coordinator of environmental science. Welcome you in this program.
Thank you Neelam. Greetings to the learner from Dr. Lakshmi Narula. I am retired associate professor from SGTB Khalsa College, University of Delhi. Presently, I am teaching in PDM University as associate professor and head of the life sciences. Today, I am going to discuss with you ecosystem. Earth is perhaps the only planet in the solar system that supports life. The portion of the Earth which sustains life is called biosphere. If we look from a distance on the Earth, the different color patches represent the large ecosystem or the biomes. Biomes are a suitable habitat for the different types of organisms due to the different physical conditions. Each biome is divided into many distinct functional units called ecosystems. Ecosystem is a self-sustaining functional unit to study the nature of ecology of the biosphere. The term ecosystem was coined by A.G. Tansley in 1935. It encompasses the complex interaction between the biotic and the abiotic components. After learning this lesson, the learner shall be able to understand the concept and the components of the ecosystem, natural and human modified ecosystem, food chain and food web, energy flow through the terrestrial and aquatic ecosystem, ecological pyramids and ecological efficiencies, growth of an ecosystem, homeostasis and ecosystem balance. The major ecosystems of the biosphere are of two types, terrestrial and aquatic. The terrestrial ecosystems are forests of different types like temperate and tropical forests or boreal forests, deserts, grasslands, tundra. Aquatic biomes are freshwater, estuaries and marine. Biosphere as well as biomes are huge and cannot be studied as a single entity. Therefore, we can study the ecological interactions in a small pond ecosystem. This is an example of a pond ecosystem showing its various components. The components of an ecosystem can be divided into two, abiotic components and biotic components. The abiotic components, physical and climatic factors, soil, inorganic and organic. The biotic components are producers, consumers and decomposers. Sun, source of heat and light. Sun is the main source of heat and light energy which are most important for life on the planet Earth. It controls all the physical and chemical factors on the Earth. This picture is showing a rainfall in the natural system and it is also called as precipitation. Precipitation is the result of condensation of atmospheric water vapors that on saturation fall on the surface of Earth under gravity. Moisture is lifted or forced to rise over a layer of sub-freezing air above the surface may be condensed into the clouds and rain. The main forms of precipitation are drizzling, rain, sleet, snow and hail. Soil is an important component of the ecosystem. The various horizons of the soil are O, A, E, B, C and R as shown in this picture. The O or the organic matter layer is undecomposed litter layer of plant residues. A, the surface soil. It is a layer of mineral soil with most organic matter accumulation and organisms. E is a lighter colored subsurface soil horizon is apparent at the base of A horizon when elevation is pronounced. B, subsoil is a layer that accumulates iron, clay, aluminium and organic compounds by the process of elevation. C, the parent rock layer of the large unbroken rock with more soluble components. R is the bedrock horizon, denote the layer of partially weathered bedrock at the base of the soil profile. Unlike above layers, Our horizon is largely comprising of continuous mass of the rock. The biotic components of an ecosystem are the producers, consumers, and decomposers. Now, what are producers? All the green plants that manufacture food for the entire ecosystem by the process of photosynthesis in the presence of sunlight are the producers. They are also called as autotrophs. In an aquatic ecosystem, they are the phytoplanktons, rooted plants, and on the terrestrial ecosystem, these are the grasses and in the grassland and trees in the forest ecosystem. The producers or the autotrophs make the food for the consumers. In an aquatic ecosystem, the main consumers are zooplanktons on depending on the herbivores. These are like paramecium, amoeba, aurelia, and daphnia, etc. Now, on the terrestrial ecosystem, the primary consumers are the herbivorous animals such as zebra, sheep, rabbit, and grasshoppers. The secondary consumers which depend upon these primary consumers are the carnivorous animals such as lion, fox, etc. The most important components which are biotic in nature are the decomposers. The decomposers are the organisms that break down the dead decaying organisms. In doing so, they carry out the natural processes of decomposition. They can be divided into two types, the macro decomposers and the micro decomposers. The macro decomposers are earthworm, which is a detritivorous feeder, and they feed upon the soil containing the dead remains of plants and animals. They break them down into the fine particles and use them as a source of energy. The micro consumers are bacteria and fungi that convert them finally into the soil nutrients. Now we come to the functional components of the ecosystem. The functional components, or which can also be called as the functional characteristics of an ecosystem, are food chains, food webs, energy flow through the ecosystem, nutrient cycles, homeostasis, and ecosystem growth. Now, this is an example of a food chain. What is a food chain now? Transfer of food energy from the producer plants through the series of organisms with repeated eating and being eaten is known as a food chain. Each step in a food chain is known as a trophic level. The trophic levels in a food chain are in the form of autotrophs, the first trophic level, second the herbivores, third the carnivores, first level carnivores, second level, and so on. There is a limited number of steps or the trophic levels in a food chain. These are the two examples of aquatic and terrestrial food chains. In natural ecosystems, the food chains are never linear. Rather, they are interconnected and make a food web. So, one organism may be a member of several food chains. For example, frog can consume fish, insect, and snail, and it can be a food for snake or any other carnivorous bird in the system. This is an example of a food chain in a small aquatic ecosystem, where you can see the phytoplanktons are the main producers. Zooplanktons are the first level consumers, which are consumed by the large fishes, and finally the large fishes can also be consumed by the birds on the shore of any aquatic ecosystem. This is another example of a food web. Whatever may be a food chain or a food web, the dead remains of all levels are taken care by the decomposers, that is bacteria and fungi, which bring back the nutrients into the substrate for their recycling. Now, the next important functional component of an ecosystem is the flow of energy through it. This is a model of energy flow through an ecosystem. The boxes indicate the standing crop biomass, and the pipes indicate the energy flowing at each trophic level from first level till the last level. Not utilized energy is is in the form of entropy, and that is the reason why at every step there is a reduction in the size of the pipe as well as the size of the box, because there is a decrease in the energy which is moving from one trophic level to the next trophic level. Not only not utilized energy is of no use to the organisms, but the energy which is lost at each trophic level due to respiration is also not available to the next trophic level. The flow of energy in an ecosystem is always linear or one way. The quantity of energy flowing through the successive trophic levels decreases as shown in the figure. At every step in a food chain or a food web, the energy received by the organisms is used to sustain itself, and the leftover energy is passed on to the next trophic level. This follows the 10% law. That is, to begin with, if it is 10,000 kilocalories primary production, it will be reduced to 1,110 finally to the top carnivorous level. Now, this energy flow through an ecosystem can also be represented graphically. The ecological pyramids are basically the graphic representation of the trophic levels of an ecosystem. They are pyramidal in shape and are of three different types: pyramid of number, pyramid of biomass, and pyramid of energy. The producer makes the base of a pyramid, and the subsequent tiers of the pyramid represent the herbivore, carnivore, and the top carnivore level in all of them. Now, first, the pyramid of number. This represents the number of organisms at each trophic level. For example, in a grassland, the number of grasses is more than the number of herbivores, and the number of herbivores is more than the number of carnivores. In some instances, the number may be inverted. The herbivores are more than the primary producers, as you can see in this diagram. There are many caterpillars and insects that feed on a single tree. Pyramid of biomass is shown in this figure. As you can see, there is a large number of grasses which are being fed by the grasshoppers, and which are being the grasshoppers which are being fed by the frogs. And at each level, the blocks are indicating the standing crop biomass. The standing crop biomass is the amount of living matter at any given time. It is expressed as gram per unit area or kilocalories per unit area. The pyramid of biomass are mostly upright. However, in some cases such as aquatic ecosystem, the pyramid of biomass may be inverted. For example, in a pond ecosystem, the phytoplanktons are the main producers. They have a very short life cycle and have a very high turnover rate. Therefore, the total biomass at any given time is always less than the total biomass of the herbivores which are supported by them. This figure is showing the pyramid of energy at each trophic level. The energy is represented in terms of the rate, such as kilocalories per unit area per unit time. It can also be represented as calories per unit area per unit time. For example, in a lake ecosystem, the energy of the autotrophs is 20,810 kilocalories, herbivores is 3,368 kilocalories, and carnivores is 383. The energy pyramids are always upright and never inverted, because at every step there is a loss of energy due to the process of respiration as well as self-sustaining systems of the organisms. Energy flow through an ecosystem can also be expressed in terms of ecological efficiency in an ecosystem. This ecological efficiency is a combination of several related efficiencies which describe the resource utilization and the extent to which the resource is converted into biomass. They are basically the ratios of the input at any trophic level to the output, which is transferred to the next trophic level by it. For example, assimilation efficiency is the amount of assimilation divided by the amount of food ingested by the organisms at a particular trophic level. Net production efficiency is the amount of consumer production divided by the amount of assimilation at the producer level. The formula for the ecological efficiency is efficiency divided by ingestion into 100, that is known as the assimilation efficiency. Net production efficiency is given as production at n level divided by the assimilation at n level. Till now we have studied about the energy flow and the food through the various trophic levels. Now in nature, all biosphere have input of energy, whereas the nutrients in an ecosystem or in the biosphere are limited. There are more than 40 elements required for the various life processes by the plants and animals. The entire earth or the biosphere is a closed system with respect to the nutrients, and neither they are imported nor they are exported from it. In the ecosystem, the flow of nutrients is cyclical. This is because the nutrient cycle from the dead remains of the organisms are released back into the soil by the detritivores and decomposers, which are absorbed again by the plants and reutilized for the synthesis of food. The recycling of the nutrients is called biogeochemical cycle or the nutrient cycle. There are two main components of the biogeochemical cycle. One, the reservoir pool, which is the atmosphere or the rock that stores the large amount of the nutrient. And the second is the cycling pool or the compartment of cycles. They are relatively short storage, for example, carbon in the form of plants and animals. This is an example of a nitrogen cycle. You can see in the figure that we have a large amount of nitrogen in the ecosystem, in the atmosphere. That is 79% of the atmosphere air is made of nitrogen. But this nitrogen cannot be utilized by the organisms directly. There are five different steps involved in the process of nitrogen cycle in the biosphere. The first step in the nitrogen cycle is fixation. The atmospheric nitrogen must be fixed in a usable form to be taken by the plants. It can be done by lightning, by industrial or the symbiotic bacteria. The second step is nitrification. It is the process by which the ammonia is converted into nitrates and nitrates by large number of bacteria. Third step is assimilation. In this process, the nitrogen fixed by the plants is converted into organic molecules such as proteins, DNA, RNA that make the plant or the animal tissue. The fourth step is ammonification, that is the nitrogenous waste products of the living organisms such as urea and uric acid and the dead remains of the organisms are converted back into the inorganic ammonia by the ammonifying bacteria. This process is known as ammonification. The last step is denitrification, that is the conversion of nitrates back into the gaseous nitrogen. Denitrifying bacteria live deep in the soil near the water table in the oxygen-free medium. Pseudomonas and Clostridium are the denitrifying bacteria. This is a figure showing carbon cycle. The main steps of the carbon cycle are photosynthesis. In the presence of sunlight, the atmospheric carbon dioxide, which is inorganic carbon, is converted into the organic carbon in the form of food. This food, which is produced by the autotrophs, is transformed into the living organism's biomass and is being utilized and metabolized by them to release energy and carbon dioxide. The third step includes decomposition. After the death and decay of the living organisms, the organic matter in the plants and the animals is completely decomposed and the carbon dioxide is released back into the atmosphere. The fourth step, which is cycling the carbon in the atmosphere, is combustion. burning of biomass in the form of coal and other products is, it releases carbon dioxide back into the atmosphere. It has a very high impact on the human body, and the excess of carbon dioxide, which is leading to the global warming, is a big issue of the day today. This is the figure showing cycling of the water in nature. The main components of the water cycle in the nature are, that is, the natural water cycle moves the water around the world through the process of evaporation, condensation and precipitation. Evaporation is the transformation of water from the liquid phase into the solid phase. Solar radiations are important in the process of evaporation. The major amount of evaporation takes place over the oceans. The second step in the process of water cycle is condensation. The transformation of water vapors, droplet in the air, creating the clouds and fogs, is the condensation process. The third is the precipitation, and the condensed water vapors that fall on the earth's surface due to the gravitational force, they are in the form of rainfall, drizzling or hail or fog, etc. Ecosystems are balanced in nature, and that is why they are called as self-sustaining systems, and they are representing a unit because they can be considered as a closed system. If in a small ecosystem which is self-sustaining, the number of producers, or for example in a pond, the phytoplanktons increase in number, obviously there will be a deficiency of nutrients. This increased number of phytoplanktons will lead to an increase in the number of zooplanktons, or the first level consumers. These zooplanktons, when consumed in large numbers, so their population will increase. When their population increases, that leads to an increase in the number of fishes which are feeding on them, and the other second and third level carnivorous animals. By and large, when the number of these organisms is increasing, the food is insufficient for them. Therefore, all the phytoplanktons will be reduced in number. When their number is reduced, stepwise, there is a reduction in the number of zooplanktons and the primary, secondary carnivorous organisms in the pond. As a result, there is revival of the nutrients in the ecosystem, and the regrowth of the phytoplanktons begins in it. The most important functional aspect of an ecosystem is that they are all dynamic. They are changing with time, and this process is known as ecosystem growth or succession. So, ecological succession or ecosystem growth is a gradual process by which the ecosystems change and develop over a time. Nothing remains same in the habitat and constantly changing. There are two main types of successions, the primary succession and the secondary succession. The primary succession is a series of community changes which occur on entirely new habitat or a virgin rock which has never been colonized before. For example, in a newly formed igneous rock, there is first in weathering of the rock which takes place, and that is initially inhabited by the most simple forms of life such as lichens, which continues to grow and become more and more complex with time. Each step in the process of succession is known as a serial stage till it reaches the climax community. For example, forest may represent the climax community. The second type of succession is known as the secondary succession, which is a series of community changes that take place on a previously colonized but disturbed or damaged habitat. In this type of habitats, there is large amount of nutrients which is already present. Therefore, it can start from a higher level of organisms. For example, in this figure, you can see that there is beginning from the perennial type of grasses, which are leading to the formation of shrubs, simple type of trees which have soft wood, and then the higher forms of trees. Thank you for your patient listening.